Welcome to this second video in our Civil Structures Back to Basics series. So we have the basic model created using Model Builder in the previous video, and we are now going to start the process of creating our conceptual or scheme design by firstly laying out our initial road alignment. We start by selecting a road assembly from the library and set out the alignment. At this early stage, we are exploring the terrain to find the best workable arrangement. Once the road is in place, we can proceed to make the changes we feel are necessary, such as adding curves and looking at the vertical alignment. We can see that in this example, the vertical alignment is fairly flat, creating quite a deep cutting, and we can change that by using the profile view and selecting a point of interest and dragging the vertical alignment into place. We can also add a point of interest at a desired location, and manipulate that in a similar way by zooming to the appropriate scale and then dragging the point into place. Once we are satisfied that the alignment is in the correct position, we can then move on to the road assembly. So far, we have been using the supplied example road assemblies, but we can now make changes to the one we have used and add that to our library for future use. Each road assembly, in what is called a component road, is made up from a number of individual components which can be selected individually and adjusted or deleted, as in this case by removing the central barrier. There is also a library not only of example road assemblies but also of the components which can then be added to the current road. So in this case we will select a curb and gutter from the library and drag it into position in between existing elements. We can then configure the extent of this new element, which could be a partial length of the road, but in this case is configured for the full extent. In addition to elements making up the road assembly, we can also add road decorations, such as we see here with the road barrier. They are added in a similar way to the road components by selecting from the library and configuring them by changing the part properties in the panel. At this stage, we can also adjust the roadside grading. The default grading is added when the component road is placed and can be changed at any time by selecting either the road itself to change all the grading on both sides or by selecting them individually to make more specific changes. Once a complete assembly has been modelled, it is then possible to select a point along the road and add the assembly at that point to our library for future use. This saved assembly can then be added to other component roads already modelled for either their partial or full length, and we will see an example of that later. So we are now at the point where we can start thinking about adding the bridge structure to our model. This is easily achieved by selecting Add Bridge from the menu and selecting two points along the alignment. A default bridge will be modelled parametrically between those two points using the built-in heuristic rules to determine a starting point for the arrangement of piers, girders, deck and abutments. We can then start to manipulate the bridge by making changes the designer feels are necessary, such as the extent of the bridge, or curvature of the alignment. At all stages, any changes invoke a remodel of the bridge, which parametrically rebuilds automatically. At the beginning of this process, we created a road assembly, which is now in use. However, we will normally require a different road assembly for the extent of the bridge itself. We can make this change by selecting Replace Assembly from the menu and selecting the extent of the change on the bridge itself. This way, the designer can introduce the changes in the road assembly to take account of the makeup of the road and also geometric changes such as superelevation. So changes in the road assembly have been made, and perhaps now the designer may want to explore different construction types or even alternative structural forms. This is a quick and efficient process using proposals, which store each scheme separately and can be switched between on demand. Once the proposal name has been entered, the designer can then make the necessary changes. In our example, The designer wishes to explore different girder types as well as the number of piers. This is done by selecting a girder and then simply changing it to a different one from the section library. In this case, changing from precast concrete to a steel clay girder. Once this change has been made, the properties of this girder can be transferred to girders in specific positions or to all girders within the bridge. Changing the number of piers is also an easy task, carried out by simply changing the number of piers in the panel. As always, the whole bridge will rebuild parametrically, automatically. This modified bridge option can be compared to previous schemes simply by switching proposals. Using this workflow, the designer can explore many scheme options at the early stage of the project, and by using the advanced toolset that we will examine in later videos in this series, model complex structural forms such as box girders, arches, cable stayed, and suspension bridge types. When exploring different options, even for simple girder construction, it is often useful to understand whether the pier spacing and number of girders is likely to be correct. The designer can confirm this early on in the design process by utilizing the analysis and design tools. An automated process can be initiated by selecting a girder or group of girders and set the analysis and design process going. A number of assumptions are necessarily made at this early stage, and the tool will automatically perform a live load optimization, structural analysis, and in this case, attendant optimization, and return the results for examination. The designer can visually explore the results by hovering over the girders to reveal the unity values. Then, once a specific girder has been selected, more detailed information will be revealed. If a deeper understanding of the analysis and design is required, it is possible to examine the full design report with all the analysis and design calculations available for inspection. All calculations that are carried out will be in accordance with the chosen design code, with each article or clause from the code explicitly called out and the full formulae and calculations available for each. That concludes this second video in the series, and the next one will concentrate on developing the design and producing early stage documentation.